Hello and welcome to the Embedded Online Conference. My name is Miro Samek, and this is part 2 of the presentation, Modern Embedded Software Goes Beyond the RTOS. For these and other reasons, the more experienced software developers learn to be very weary of blocking, and instead they apply a set of best practices to reduce the blocking in their software. From the historical perspective, these best practices combine the RTOS, object-oriented programming, and event-driven programming. I will call these trends modern, as in the title of this presentation. So for the purposes of this talk, modern embedded systems programming means anything invented after the mid-1980s. This is in contrast to the still dominating traditional approach, based on a traditional RTOS and shared state concurrency that dates back to the early 1980s when RTOS went mainstream. The great Danish quantum physicist Niels Bohr used to define an expert as a man who has made all the mistakes which can be made, in a narrow field. In this sense, experts in the field of concurrency notice that the use of naked threads and the multitude of blocking mechanisms often leads to systems that are unresponsive, difficult to reason about, and often unsafe. Instead, software experts from various industries independently started to arrive at the same conclusions about safer and more robust embedded software architecture. These modern approaches universally favor strictly encapsulated threads that don't share anything, are allowed to communicate only by exchanging events or messages, and that use blocking only to wait for events, but otherwise don't block at all. Please note that the best practices don't dismiss the RTOS. The threads are still there. But while a naked RTOS allows you to do anything, the modern approaches go beyond the RTOS by restricting the use of threads to a specific set of best practices. One of the most succinct formulations of these best practices I found comes from the C++ and concurrency expert Herb Sutter. Specifically, his article, Prefer Using Active Objects Instead of Naked Threads, contains the following three best practices, which I rephrase here as follows. 1. Keep data isolated, private, and bound to threads. This means avoid sharing of data or resources among threads. This eliminates the shared state concurrency node in the perils of blocking diagram. Without sharing, there is no need for mutual exclusion, and a big part of the vicious cycle is eliminated. Of course, avoid sharing is easy to say, but how are then the threads supposed to communicate and synchronize? Well, this is addressed in the best practice number 2. Communicate among threads via asynchronous events. This best practice packs two important concepts, events or messages, and asynchronous communication. Event objects, also called messages, are packed data specifically designed for communication. They carry the information about what happened, for example, a timeout occurred, or button 1 was pressed, or button 2 was released. Additionally, event objects can carry event parameters that pertain to the event. For example, an Ethernet packet arrived event can carry the whole Ethernet data packet as its event parameter. You will see examples of events in a minute. Asynchronous communication means that senders of events only post the events to the recipients, but they don't wait in line, meaning don't block, until the event is processed. So the best practice number 2 is designed to eliminate the synchronization by blocking node from the perils of blocking diagram. And finally, the best practice number 3. Organize your threads around message pumps. Goes directly after the blocking node in the diagram. Please note that the blocking node cannot be eliminated completely, at least not with a traditional RTOS, because as you remember, every RTOS thread must necessarily block somewhere in its superloop. But the best practice number 3 prescribes the only allowed structure of the superloop as the message pump, which restricts the blocking to only one specific place in the loop. So let's take a closer look at an event loop, also known as a message pump, implemented here with the FreeRTOS API. The basic architecture is very simple. It consists of the usual forever super loop with just two steps, waiting for an event and dispatching the event for processing. The waiting for events is implemented with the message queue that blocks when no events are available. Shown here in red, this is the only place in the loop that blocks. Once an event is received, the event loop processes the event in the dispatch call, which is not allowed to block. This is the most important restriction of the event loop with the most far-reaching consequences. The first consequence of the no-blocking restriction is that dispatch must process one event at a time, to completion, and necessarily return back to the event loop in order to start processing the next event. This is called run-to-completion, RTC, event processing. The second consequence is that dispatch cannot be coded sequentially with the usual wait-respond paradigm. This would not only clog the event loop and make it unresponsive, but it would also violate the run-to-completion event processing requirement. How so? Well, any instance of blocking really represents waiting for an event, and unblocking represents reception of the awaited event. But such an event would then arrive through the backdoor of blocking in the middle of processing of the original event from the queue. So you would now process two events at a time, thus violating the RTC semantics of event processing. And finally, the third consequence of event loop is that it leads to inversion of control compared to the traditional RTOS. In an RTOS, you write the body of each and every thread, and you, meaning the application developer, choose which RTOS blocking mechanisms you employ in your code. Event loop reverses it because it predetermines the structure of every thread, and it calls your code, the dispatch code. Moreover, you are no longer allowed to use any RTOS blocking mechanisms in that code. Of course, all these best practices combined establish a design pattern, which is known as the active object pattern. In this pattern, active objects, like any other objects, have private data. But each active object also has a private thread and a private event queue. The only way to interact with an active object is by posting events to its event queue. The posting is asynchronous, meaning that event is only placed in the queue, but there is no waiting until the event is processed. The event processing happens in the event loop running in the private thread of the active object. The processing might involve sending secondary events to other active objects or even to self. In a sense, active objects are the most stringent form of object-oriented programming because the asynchronous communication enables active objects to be truly encapsulated. In contrast, the traditional OOP encapsulation, as provided by C++, C# or Java, does not really encapsulate anything in terms of concurrency. Any operation on an object runs in the callers thread, and the object's private data are subject to the same race conditions as global data, not encapsulated at all. To become thread-safe, operations need to be explicitly protected by a mutual exclusion mechanism, such as a mutex or a monitor. But this reduces parallelism dramatically, causes contention, and is a natural enemy of scalability. In contrast, all private data of an active object are truly encapsulated for concurrency without any mutual exclusion mechanism because they can be only accessed from the active object's own thread. Note that this encapsulation for concurrency is not a programming language feature, so it is no more difficult to achieve in C as in C++, but it requires a programming discipline to avoid sharing resources, known as the share-nothing principle. However, the event-based communication helps immensely because instead of sharing a resource, a dedicated active object can become the manager or broker of that resource, and the rest of the system can access the resource only via events posted to this broker active object. The active object pattern is valuable because it naturally implements and automatically enforces the best practices of concurrent programming. The pattern also dramatically improves your ability to reason about your thread's code and operation by giving you higher-level abstractions and idioms that raise the semantic level of your program and let you express your intent more directly and safely, thus improving your productivity. As most good ideas in software, the concept of autonomous software objects communicating by message passing is not new. It can be traced back to the mid-1970s when Carl Hewitt at MIT came up with the actor model of computation. That's why the active object pattern is sometimes also called the actor model. In the mid-1990s, methodologies like real-time object-oriented modeling, RUM, adapted actors for real-time computing. More recently, Unified Modeling Language, UML, introduced the concept of active objects that are essentially synonymous with the RUM actors. Both variants use hierarchical state machines, UML state charts, to model the internal behavior of active objects. I'll talk about state machines a bit later.